Hi, so sorry.
Sorry for your loss.
So sorry for your loss.
Sorry for your loss.
Oh, hey, man.
Hey, man, what's going on?
Nothing. Sucks, huh?
Yeah, man, this really sucks.
I'm good. So young.
I know. You know what they say. You gotta remember the good times, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Hey. Do you remember the Little League?
Oh, yeah. Remember that game where he couldn't even throw the ball? We were just like,
that was so fun.
Remember what he wore to prom?
Oh my goodness, yes.
What the thing? You thought it looked good? It was like this, like purple.
He was nuts. Sorry,
excuse me.
Oh gosh.
He was the best.
You know, remember? Do you remember?
Sorry. You gotta stop.
Sorry, okay. What? Okay, Jude.
Dude,
I'm sorry.
Stop.
Do you remember when he died?
Too soon. Way too soon.
Hey, everybody. I'm Chris.
And I'm Paul.
Welcome to the Chris and Paul Podcast.
Hooray!
It's happening. Finally happening.
We're here. We're doing a podcast.
If you guys don't know who we are, I'm Chris.
And I'm Paul.
See you later. We were just on NBC's Bring the Funny over the summer. We are the two-man act that wore the vest and tie.
And I wore the blue shirt and tie.
And we made it all the way to the finals. And it was amazing. And we lost. So.
Yeah.
This is going to be a podcast about us bitching our asses off. No, we've wanted to do this for a while. We have a lot of projects happening right now, which we're very excited about. And we decided, let's talk to you guys. Right, Paul?
Yes, we're going to talk to you about, we have lots of ideas and antics.
This is going to be real fun. Antics. This show, it's got a lot for you. We're going to play some games. We're going to interview a lot of... A lot of big-name comedians who you guys know that are traveling all over the world. So we're very excited about this. And this podcast right now, we just kind of wanted to introduce ourselves, say hi, know what's going on.
Get to know us a little bit. Get a little personal.
So if you did see us on Bring the Funny, you guys would know somewhat about our backstory. Paul and I met 20 years ago at our hometown in Stamford, Connecticut.
At a community theater called Curtain Call.
Yes, Curtain Call, that's where we met. Awesome community theater. Please go to it if you're in the area. Great shows, great atmosphere.
And that's where we met, Chris. I was doing shows there, and I remember seeing you for the first time at Curtain Call.
Yeah, Paul, so the first time I remember seeing Paul, Paul was breaking boards. Was that what you were doing?
Yes, I was breaking boards, showing off to all the girls.
Where did you find the wood? I don't understand.
I don't know. I think there was some construction going on.
You just grabbed wood and started breaking it?
I'm like, hey, I can break wood. It's one thing I can do.
That was Paul's big pickup line when he was back in the day.
I can break
wood. Hey, what's up, babe? You want to see me break this board? what board? He runs outside and runs back in with something.
Here, I can break this. Watch.
But I remember meeting him there, and I was in the lobby, and he was just like, hey, I break wood. This is back in 99. I think I was 16, 17.
Yeah.
And I held a piece of wood. Paul was ready to break it, and then I chickened out. I was like, I'm not doing this.
Yeah.
I said, no thanks, but nice to meet you. And then through a mutual friend, our friend Darren, I found out that Paul wanted to do a comedy troupe. He wanted to put together a sketch comedy group, and I had no idea what sketch was. And then I met Paul. And then we discussed what was going on. So, Paul, what were you thinking about back then?
So, I remember I was a few years out of high school, and I was getting into acting, and I didn't really know what I wanted to do performance-wise, but I just started discovering I was like the Three Stooges and Kids in a Hall, and I didn't know a lot of comedy troupes. I knew a lot of stand-up, like Carlin and Pryor and, whoever was on Jeff Foxworthy, whoever was on A&E at that time. They had an improv show. But yeah, I wanted to be like the next kids in the hall. So I remember getting into curtain call and doing the show called Run for Your Wife, where I knew of Darren because I met him a few times at class. And then he would mention Chris, and I knew of Chris also. And then we all met up at Darren's house one day, and Chris and I kind of hit it off. I remember seeing you in a play, Run for Your Wife, at
No, that's what Stamp you High. Said you were in.
No, not Run for Your Wife. I'm sorry. Noises
I was
like, Off.
I was there too?
Noises Off.
That's I was in Noises Off.
I saw you in Noises Off, yeah. And I remember you were the burglar, and I remember the sheet coming off you, and you made this funny face. I go, that kid is funny.
I like how you said burglar.
Burglar. Yeah, so that's what I remember, and I remember meeting you at a Circuit City parking lot.
Yeah, my buddy Bill and I, we just got into a fender bender, and the guy got out of the car, and he was like, "So you hit me," and we were like, "Oh, sorry," and then he's like, "It's okay, I'll fix it," and he opened his trunk, and he pulled out a crowbar, and just started like hitting his car with a crowbar.
What?
And we're like, "Oh, yeah, you didn't know that?"
No.
The guy started like jacking his car up, so it looked like we like screwed his car up. And Bill and I were like young. We're like, "Oh, we don't know what to do." And then Paul like walks by, and we're like, "Oh, hey, man, this guy, you know, we just hit a car." And he's like, "Sweet." And,
yeah.
Paul is just like, "I'm gonna go and buy some wood so I can break some more boards for girls."
Oh, that's fun.
And so anyway, so I found out that Paul wanted to put together this comedy troupe. And I'm an idiot because earlier in that year, like this was around the fall. So this is like September. I went to my principal. I was friends with his son, and I was a horrible student. I was terrible. I think my final GPA was like 1.6 because I just never went to school. It was bad. But I was like, can I do a comedy show at the end of the year? Because I was doing improv shows in town, and I thought I was funny. And I was like, I would go on stage and I'd be like, F word. And, you know, 15-year-old girls would laugh, and I'm like, I'm the king of the world. And that was relevant back then because that movie was number one. So Paul puts together this group of our friends, and we have a meeting. And I was like, Paul's like, where are we going to do our first show? And I was like, I have no idea. And then meanwhile, I didn't realize that, you know, I had a show at the end of the year in May. May 20th, my principal was like, yeah, you can have that in the big auditorium. What are you going to do? I was like, I have no idea. And he was like, all right, it's all yours. And I was like, guys, I got this date. We have a show. We have a sketch show. We got to figure it out. So we had all year to write this thing. And that's kind of what the year was. It was like learning how to write.
And we had no idea how to write. I knew, never wrote a sketch in my life.
Yeah, Paul got me into the kids in the hall. I had heard of them in before, but never really watched them. And I was like, oh my God, these guys are great. And we're like, yeah, we're going to do like this. And I remember we saw them on tour.
Yes.
And that was awesome. So we saw like a live sketch show. And that was like the first live real sketch show we saw.
That was really, for me, that was amazing because I'd never seen a live sketch show before.
Yeah, I mean, and this is like back in 99. Paul, like right now, if you're in the city, there's like UCB and The Pit, and there's other big like improv theaters that do a lot of sketch. Back then, it wasn't like the big, it definitely wasn't as big as it is now by any means. And so we saw the show, and I remember we were like, oh, we're going to do exactly that. And by exactly that, like, I remember they opened the show and they had like a silhouette of them before they came on, and like, there was like pre-show music, and we're writing it down. Like,
yeah. They were all dressed up as the girls from the Office.
Yep.
Yeah, Kathy. Kathy. Yeah. That was fun.
So we kind of janked their opening. We were just like, all right, we got to do what they're doing because clearly they know what they're doing. So that whole year, my senior year of high school, was just kind of writing and producing our first sketch show, and I was 17. And, yeah, I remember in school I would put up these flyers all over the school, and in the middle, in the center of the paper, in very tiny print, it said, oh, it was also called the Chris O'Neill Comedy Show. and this wasn't like an ego thing.
You had no idea you wanted what to do with the show, right?
No, I had no idea. I had this date. So they marked it in the calendar, oh, the Chris O'Neill Comedy Show.
May 20th.
2000. So that's what the show ended up being. Like, they printed the tickets, and then I was like, great. So if this show sucks, I'm the only one that's going to get shit for it.
That was your senior year?
That was my senior year. Senior year of high school, baby.
Wow.
Horrible student, but I was like, I'm going out with a bang. So the whole year was just promoting the show. And our friend Bill did this really great impression of a very famous comedian who, it's just, you know, we can't really even mention his name because let's call him Dr. Huxtable. He did a great Dr. Huxtable impression. And rumor got out that we were going to do a bit where he would do this impression. So rumor got out that Dr. Huxtable might show up to this show and be in the show. And I, you know, we didn't think anything of it. But turns out, like, it really spread fast. So fast forward to the show, May 20th. Paul's dad worked for this car and limo service. And we were like, let's arrive in style. So we spent, well, we scrounged together like all the money we had.
Yeah, it was like 100, 150 bucks or something like that. My dad had a connection and got a double stretch limo for us.
Yeah, we basically rented a limo for like a half an hour.
There were six or seven of us in the
It was our whole troop. And yeah. It literally just drove us up the street and parked in front of the school. And
we waited there and we waited.
We were like, let's be funny and like, let's just wait. And when we pulled up, everyone almost crapped our pants because there were hundreds and hundreds of people waiting outside to come into the show. And we were like, oh man, maybe this Dr. Huxtable rumor kind of got out of control. But anyway, it had been months of promoting the show. And the show was great. We had a great time. It was our first show we did together.
We did a O Fortuna opening.
Yeah, it was played O Fortuna. We had like silhouettes. It was this whole production. And then production.
We did an NSYNC thing, I remember. We had a lot of pretty insane.
It was just dumb.
It was a dumb, silly, but fun. But you know what? It got us started because.
Definitely got us started.
Yeah.
And the thing was, we had about 500 people there.
A little more than I remember than Mike Lamone saying we had close to 700 people.
Which was crazy. And this is our first show together. And I was like, wow, is this how it usually is? It's not. It's definitely not. And so we did the show. It went well. And like at the end of the show, I'm like riding high. I'm like, this is it. My high school career, this is the best thing in the world. And then I got arrested in front of everyone that was there, all the students leaving the school. These two big cops came up to me as everyone was walking out of the auditorium, and they were like, hey, are you Chris? And I was like, yeah. And then I'm thinking they're going to like congratulate me, and they like, oh, you're under arrest, and they jack me up against the wall, and I'm like, what's happening? And they're like, where are your parents? And I'm like, oh, I don't know. I think they're home. I don't know what's happening. And I'm like shaking.
Yeah.
And I remember hearing one kid go, oh my God, Chris is getting arrested. And everyone like turned around like, oh my God, what's happening?
I felt so bad for you because I knew about it. And the guys begged me not to tell you.
Yeah, no.
And I wanted to tell you so bad. And I was like, no, don't do this to him. It's pissed off. Oh, it'd be so fun to be so funny. I'm so sorry. I never told you, Chris.
No, it was actually really cool because they put me up against the wall and they were like, you know, saying Dr. Huxtable is going to be here and not having it. He doesn't show up. You can't make money on like false advertising. And I don't know, whatever the hell they said. I believed it. And I was like, I'm going to jail forever. And
did they cuff you?
Yes.
They
cuffed me and slammed me against the wall.
They
had my face against the wall. And at the time, I was like 100 pounds. So I was just like. And I'm like shitting my pants.
I felt so bad.
And then I look over and I see my friends laughing. I'm like, what the fuck is this? And then it turns out that my friend Darren, who introduced Paul and I, his dad was a cop and they thought it'd be funny to do a prank on me. But the cool thing was it was like a McLovin thing from Superbad because the rumor was like I got arrested. And like I remember people afterwards, we all went to like a party and they were like, what happened? You got arrested? I was like, yeah, no, it's cool. I sorted it out. It's all good. I'm in with the cops.
You're cool.
And that was it.
So I think one of our, what you and I really connected, we talk about all time, is one of our last sketches we did a parody of Who's On First called Who the Hell's On First.
And that was the first sketch we did.
Was it the opening?
That was the opening sketch.
That was the opening sketch? Yeah. Okay.
Oh, that was the first time I did a sketch with Paul. And I remember at the end of, in that scene, it was like a spoof on the Who's On First bit, the Abbott and Costello thing. And I had a lollipop. I played a kid. It was silly. And I remember I offered it to Paul. It wasn't in the script, but I was like, I called him Mr. Fat Man. I was like, you want my lollipop? And Paul just, it was in my mouth the whole sketch. And then Paul grabbed it and put it in his mouth. And I remember the crowd was like, oh, what the, that's gross. And I was
almost started laughing.
I was like, oh my God, this guy's crazy. He put my lollipop in his mouth. And as small as it was, I was like, wow, that guy doesn't care. That's awesome. And that was the moment I was like, all right, this guy's...
We still have that on VHS somewhere.
That was the first time I knew that Paul will do anything for a laugh. We've done shows where I have a trump card with Paul where I go, just trust me. Doesn't matter if we're arguing about a sketch. I go, trust me, it's going to work. And then it'll work. But Paul will always just be game. Like, I was like, I just always remember this one bit. I was like, Paul was playing a waiter in one of the sketches. And I was like, you know, it'd be funny if you were like, wearing a thong. Well, I don't remember what the hell the sketch was.
No, you said, would you just walk on the stage in your underwear? I said, okay.
Yeah, Paul just did it.
But then I pulled
the underwear up your ass.
Yeah, my butt cheeks. Yeah.
But Paul, yeah, so as you can see, like Paul, when we were on Bring the Funny, it's just weird to think of that we were on NBC and it's like Paul was half naked in front of millions of people. And that was fun.
Yeah.
So Paul will do anything. Paul gets, you know, drenched with milk.
I have to. Yeah, you have to go for it. If you don't go for it, then what's the point?
Yeah.
That's my philosophy.
And you know who wrote what sketch when Paul's the one taking all the hits, and I'm just like, oh, yeah, I'll stand over here and let you do that.
Yeah. There's countless times where you would call me or text me when we lived in New York City and say, hey, can you do this? I'm like, yeah, sure. Yeah.
Yeah, Paul's like, yeah, okay, fine.
I appreciate you just asking me, though. Like, just you know, I would do it anyway. It's just like you putting it out there just to ask me.
Yeah, but Paul always said that it was like him playing. What is it in my head?
Yeah, if I think of the Chris and Paul show as me playing in Chris's head.
So Paul's like the big kid, and I'm like, it's like, will you do this? And Paul's like, yep. Yeah. And then I'll do it, and it's like, awesome.
Yeah.
Because there's things I'm like, ah, no, I don't want to do that. And then Paul's like, yeah, I'll do it. If it gets a laugh, I don't care.
Yeah.
But yeah, so Paul and I that show, that May 20th, that was when I got addicted to doing comedy. And I was such a bad student. I have so many teachers in my family. They all wanted me to go to school. I got into like one college, barely. And I was like, after that show, I was like, I'm not going. I got to move to the city and do comedy. And I remember Paul's older than I am. And he was back then as well. Go figure. And I remember my mom
That's
was
how
like,
math works.
I think Paul was 22, and I was like 17. Yeah. And my mom was like, who the hell is this 22-year-old weirdo like talking
Hanging
to my
out
son?
With you guys, yeah.
Breaking wood and like and trying to get you to be funny with him and having you over his apartment. And she was just kind of creeped out by the whole thing. Since then, you know, she met Paul and, oh, yeah, that's Paul.
Yeah.
Paul.
But, yeah, there was a part where I became so close to your family, you wouldn't be there, and I would go to your house and see if you were home. Because we only had beepers back then. We didn't have a cell phone. So I would stop by. Hey, is Chris around? And your mom would be like, no. You want some dinner?
Yeah, Paul's like, yes, I do. And then my mom would feed it. I had no idea forever. And
yeah.
So yeah, she was like not jazzed about the idea of me wanting to move to the city to do comedy with this random 22-year-old weirdo. But I was like, I need to do it. Basically, long story short, I kind of got temporarily kicked out of my house. They temporarily changed the locks.
And you temporarily lived with me.
I temporarily stayed on Paul's couch. And I was working at the mall, and he lived right near the mall. So it was a perfect
Very
setup.
Convenient.
And I remember Paul would get home, and I'd like have all these people over all the time. Paul's house was like, his apartment was great because I would throw parties there all the time. I go, yeah, let's write. And then, but so-and-so's coming over. With like 8 other people. And Paul's like, dude, okay, fine. So that whole summer, I was like, we got to move to the city. We have to perform in the city. We just have to do it. And I was hooked. And Paul called up clubs and pretended he was
a manager. Yeah. I said, yeah, I have a 2-man act. And like, yeah, come on down. Just bring 3 people.
I still remember where you were sitting. You were sitting at your desk and like lean over. You're like, yeah, we got a show next week. And I was like, what?
Yeah, come next Wednesday. It was a Wednesday night, I remember. And
yeah,
the guy
prime
says,
slot for New York comedy.
Yeah, and he goes, yeah, come. I think the show was, the showcase started at 8 o'clock, but we didn't get it until late. There's a lot of shows where we went in late. It depended on.
A lot of the shows we did started at 7, and we wouldn't get on, literally, we wouldn't get on until 12:30 at
sometimes,
night.
Yeah, I think the latest was 1:15, and we had to rush back to the train. But if you didn't, so you brought 3 people. And if you didn't bring
those 3
people.
I thought it was more than that. Some of them
were 3. Some of them were 5.
Some were 10.
But if like.
Not the ones that were 10.
Yeah. So
like,
yeah.
It's a big showcase, guys.
Yeah. So even if we brought our 3, if someone brought 5 or more, we would get bumped to 9 o'clock, then 10 o'clock, then 11 o'clock. Yeah. In the beginning, we did okay. We did earlier shows because we had friends that would come see us. But then we
They were like, wow, you guys are really doing it. And then they would see the that we performed. They go, all right.
But then they were spending like $30-$40 just to come see us do 5 minutes.
You get to 2-drink minimum. If you guys have ever gone to a comedy club, it gets pretty pricey.
We're not trying to
tell you not to come to our shows now. Please come. We're touring the country now.
So. We're a lot better. I mean, we've gone from writing bits on the train.
We were so excited that we were performing in New York that, like, on the train in, we're like, this is so crazy. I can't believe we're performing at a real club. And then we go, oh, God, what are we going to do? We literally would write our act on the train. Yeah. Then we would perform it and then run back to Grand Central. And there have been so many nights where we missed the train and we had to stay over in Grand Central. Or if it was, like, the weather was bad.
Yeah.
I remember I had a friend that was like in NYU, and we went down there to try to get into her dorm, and they wouldn't let us in, so we just rolled the street.
You needed a license to get in, but your license was ripped. You didn't have it or something.
We used to go to Times Square to the McDonald's, with the big overhang, the big the heat lamps, and we'd just stand under there for like 3 hours until the train started running again.
So many New York,
but we loved it. We're like, this is amazing.
This is great. We were in New York City. We loved it.
And then we finally scrounge up enough money to move in. I remember we were like, let's start looking for places, and we didn't know what the hell we were doing, but we found this place. It was right behind Lincoln Center, which was like it's the most beautiful area in the world, right near Juilliard, and it was like kind of like these like dinky little apartments. But I remember this guy who our landlord was like this asshole. Remember that guy? And he was just like,
yeah.
We had other friends. He was just a dick. And, like, he's like, yo, let me show you some places, all right? All right. And, like, opens this door on this tiny little woman and her son. And when I say this woman was, like, 4'11", and the son was...
And they were cooking, or she was cooking something.
They were eating dinner at this tiny little... It was a very small family. It was this mother and a son sitting at a table eating dinner, and he just barges in, opens the door, and he's like, so this is the place. They're going to be moving out at the end of... And Paul and I were mortified. We're like, oh, my God, we felt so bad. The lady just was like, oh, my God. So we just peeked in real quick. Yeah, that's
great. We'll take it.
Yeah, we'll take it. And we didn't really take a look at the place. So we're like, all right, so we're going to put a down payment.
We put down $3,300.
This place, let me tell you.
$3,300 for this 16x8 studio.
16x8. All right. This is small. I mean, New York, places are small. This is really small for one person and a tiny little family. Paul and I... This was insane. So anyway, this is the place we're going to move to. We were so excited. My parents were still kind of pissed that I was like moving to the city, but they were like, let him try it and fall in his face figure it out. So I remember we're all excited, and Paul and his dad drive in first to go with his U-Haul to drop stuff off, or your car or whatever it was. And my dad and I drove in after that to bring the rest of the stuff. And I remember I pull around the corner and I see Paul's dad. And Paul's dad's like old school Brooklyn Italian, slick back hair.
Yeah.
Like, don't mess with me. I'm fucking kicking your ass. And I just remember seeing him screaming on the sidewalk, just like pissed off. And Paul was like ghost white. And Paul like looked, he was just like mortified. And I was like,
I was with my brother and my dad.
Your brother was there. He was instigating.
Yeah, he was listening to the whole thing.
So we pulled in, and then Paul's dad's like, oh, Jesus, Rich, you got to see what the fuck did these kids do? And they walked in, and then that's when Paul and I finally, like, saw how small the place really was. Ugh. You know, after we had paid $3,000 to move in, and my dad's like, oh, my God. And we literally they had to bring back about 75 to 80% of the stuff we try to bring there.
Because
it just physically wouldn't
fit. I just remember when we were packing up at my place. I think you already packed up. And then I'm taking everything I had because I was living with my dad at the time. And I remember taking everything and putting it in. And you look at me and you go, we don't have the room. I go, we have a closet.
Oh, yeah. This closet fit like a leg. That's how small. I mean, it was like maybe half a broom fit in this freaking closet.
All your clothes.
So we squeezed
and
in.
My clothes were in our beds.
Yeah, we squeezed in as many boxes as possible. And
they took the rest.
They took the rest home. And like Paul's brother is a little younger than Paul, but he's just like.
Antagonized it.
Oh my God. He's like, Dad, I can't believe what he did. Oh my God. Paul's whole family talks like that.
You messed up, man. You messed up.
I was like, oh man, what are you guys thinking? And I remember they left. And Paul and I sat in this tiny ass apartment. And we couldn't even see each other because the boxes were up to the ceiling.
Yeah.
They were just crammed in there. And I remember just, we just sat in silence.
I remember Chris popped up his head. And I go, well, here we go. We're doing this.
Oh, and it was like, that was the beginning of us in the city. And like, Jesus, I can't believe. I still want to go back to that place to look and see.
A couple of years before I moved out of the city, I walked in the neighborhood again.
Really?
Still shady.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was actually a really cool building.
A cool building. We were right near Tower Records, which is Lincoln Center now.
Yep.
Well, we used to get our DVDs from there.
No, what is it now? It's like Bed Bath & Beauty. No, it's...
No, it's the Lincoln Center Expanded.
Lincoln Center expanded?
Yeah, Lincoln Center took all that. Yeah, it's incredible.
But this place had a courtyard, an enclosed courtyard, and it had its own gym. And it was like a tiny gym, but it was free. So, I mean, it was not bad. And going home every night, you walk through Lincoln Center with like the fountain, and you're like, I'm living it. And this is amazing.
Yeah, no, it was a great location.
And there was a lot of like I remember there was like Rockettes that lived there. There's a lot of Juilliard people, a lot of AMDA students, a lot of musical theater.
Musical theater.
Pretty girls everywhere. Paul and I were like, oh, this is awesome. And it didn't matter how, I mean, so this place, we had a bunk bed and it literally just fit. It was just small enough. I mean, literally, if you extended your arms and you just leaned half inch to one way or the other, you would touch the wall.
Easily.
And you'd step out of the bed.
I just can't believe it. And we had friends sleep over.
Yeah, we had two girlfriends at the time.
Yes, that's right.
And they were so excited.
Yeah, that was fun. Oh my goodness. Yeah, we have a lot of stories like that. And I think this is what our podcast is going to be. Chris and I have been together for 20 years. And we have all this experience that we want to talk about and share. And then people who we met along the way and talk with them and share with them. So we're just excited. We have a lot of cool things.
Yeah, this is just the beginning. We have, I'm so excited. You'll find out soon. We've already confirmed. We've already done a few interviews. We're going to be interviewing some really awesome comedians and some great friends.
People who we met years ago who are still doing it.
People that we performed with. People that you've seen on Bring the Funny. People from our past, people that you've seen all. I mean, I'm super jazzed and excited. Yeah. And we have some fun games. You're going to hear some audio sketches that we're able to do. Because if you've seen us on Bring the Funny, we don't use a whole lot of props. We've learned that from performing at the clubs when we started off.
Don't need that.
When we started off, like, UCB was the theater, but it wasn't what it is now. It was like the old UCB, like really old. It was like 2001?
Yeah, 2000. Yeah, Second City was there.
Was it near Gotham? I forget where it was.
Wait. Oh,
I remember we did a show with Amy Poehler and like the original cast.
Yeah.
I don't know what the hell that was.
Yeah, we hosted it or something. It was a show we hosted. We went there a couple times. I don't know how. I can't remember how we got in, but I just remember
our friend. Oh, Dan Levy. Our friend Dan Levy.
Oh, maybe that was it. Yeah, yeah.
Dan Levy is also from our hometown. Right now, he's a writer, producer of The Goldbergs. You've seen him. Look him up. Dan Levy. Not the Dan Levy. Not Dan Levy from Schitt's Creek. Dan Levy. Hysterical guy. Good guy. Very funny.
We know him for years, too.
And hopefully we'll get him on this, too.
Yeah. Definitely.
But yeah.
Yeah, you'll know more about us. You'll get some stories and know who we are. In fact, I don't know if you know this, but Chris O'Neill was on Book of Mormon, was in Book of Mormon 2.5 years on the First National Tour and then 2.5 years on Broadway. So a little over 5 years, right,
Chris? That is crazy. Yeah. Yes, I was. If you guys, I don't know if anyone's watched any Broadway shows or know the Book of Mormon. Hopefully you do. I played Elder Cunningham for about a little over 5 years. And that's the funny thing, because it's like, I don't even know what my stage name is Christopher John O'Neill. So people look up Chris O'Neill, it's like, I think like a prince from some country comes up. But no, I did that for a while.
Yeah, and I saw you six times.
Paul saw me six times.
Super fan. That was great. It was pretty surreal watching you for the first time on stage. And
that was a weird time. Paul and I both auditioned for this part. I luckily paid them off and lucked out. but Paul and I...
Also, you can sing.
Well, I hate my voice.
No, I love it.
I hate my
voice.
Speaking voice. It's nasally. It sucks. I hear myself. I don't even know I'm doing a podcast. I should just like have someone else.
So we hear ourselves. Yeah. What?
I'll write something and someone else reads it.
Yeah.
I don't know what the hell this is. But basically, we want to do this for like short enough amount of time for like your ride to work. This is. It's not all going to be like this. We've got a lot of fun stuff in store. It's going to be bonkers. It's going to be an experience. It's not just going to be us talking with my nasally voice.
And me agreeing with his nasally voice.
Wow.
Ooh, I'm kidding. I don't like my voice either. I think your voice is fine.
I like your voice.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Wow.
That reminds me of, for whatever reason, like one of our first comedy meetings for that May show when I was in high school.
Yeah.
I got grounded.
Oh, yeah.
I got grounded. So I was like, Paul, I can't come to the meeting
tonight.
Well,
here's the thing. I kept on paging you because Chris had a pager.
You know, I sold drugs on the side. You know me. It was 1999.
It's just before cell phones. And I go,
no, cell phones were out.
They were there, but they were like, they were way too expensive and beepers were
a lot
cheaper.
Zach Morris had a cell phone.
But.
Oh, no, that was just a mobile phone.
Yeah. But I kept on paging and paging. And I was like, where are you? And then you called like, hey, you were whispering.
I gotta whisper. And I think my mom like during like
your
we're,
mom
like,
picked up the phone. And she goes, you go, Mom, I'm in a comedy meeting. And she goes, I don't care where you are. You're not supposed to be on the phone. You're grounded.
And I hear everyone laughing. I'm like, I gotta go, guys. That's how long we've been doing comedy together.
Chris, Jesus. We're getting grounded. We were doing comedy.
Oh, I feel so old.
Oh, but yeah, we're excited to do this because it's just an opportunity to tell you. We've been together for 20 years, so we have a lot of stories to share and a lot of bits to share and a lot of friends that we want to share with you guys.
Oh, my God. I'm excited.
Yeah.
Are you guys excited? Let me hear you.
Let me hear you.
All right.
Yep, they're all excited.
Good. All right, well, guys, thanks so much. This is just the introduction. Stay tuned next time for some really cool stuff.
Ooh.
Oh, my God.
Tell me, Chris.
I can't. But it involves a fan favorite from a certain show
that we might have done over
that we may have been with. A super fan favorite.
Yeah.
Who may or may not be human. We've said too much. All right. I'm Chris.
I'm Paul.
Bye.
Goodbye.